Hi and welcome to News Laundry. Today on News Laundry we have Rahul Pandita, but more importantly we are sitting at the Jaipur Literature Festival, and I don't know whether you can hear, but in the background Kapil Sibal is reciting poetry, and I don't think there can be any better setting for an interview. What do you think, Rahul? Can you hear that poetry?
Yeah. I met him a couple of times.
As a poet or as a minister?
No, privately, okay. In a couple of social occasions, and he has a keen interest in my work. He was very curious to know about what is happening in Chhattisgarh and elsewhere. So we had a private chat a couple of times, yes.
Okay, so Rahul Pandita is associate editor of The Open magazine, and you've written that book, Hello Bastar.
That's right.
And you've reported extensively from conflict zones, yeah. Baghdad, Bastar. And you grew up in Kashmir, is that right?
Oh, that's right.
So we're going to talk about reporting and news media, but before that, about conflict zones and your personal experiences there.
Well, as far as the Maoist insurgency is concerned, I've been going in these areas for the last 12 years. Mm. And that was the time I remember when every journalist worth his salt would go to Kashmir, because Kashmir was, quote-unquote, the sexy insurgency.
And you lived there at the time?
And no, I've left Kashmir in 1990.
Okay.
After militancy erupted in that area, I was 14. So I was an affected party as far as Kashmir goes, not that I have not reported from Kashmir as well.
Does it get in the way?
At times, yes, but I try to steer clear of it.
Is it possible? But
it is, of course.
Why not? You can be dispassionate about
having left. As a journalist, you're talking about certain things, and the problem with journalism is that sometimes when you take a stand, it somehow has to get bracketed in in this left wing or right wing, etc. So that, because of my interest in in the Maoist areas and a lot of extensive reporting from these areas, there are some people who think that I'm a Maoist sympathizer. And
are you?
I say certain.
Are you Maoist? What is a Maoist sympathizer?
I'll tell you. We'll get to that also. But and on the other hand, I have certain things to say about Kashmir. So some people believe that I'm a right-wing fascist. So as a journalist, I find it a very comfortable position to be in.
To be a right-wing fascist and a Maoist sympathizer.
And a Maoist sympathizer. It's brilliant as far as journalism goes. But coming back to conflict reporting, you see, what is happening is that I'm really amused at some of my fellow journalists who report from the red sandstones of the Raisina Hills and from the Parliament and from the North and South Block. And they use some of these really fancy terms. It's called journalistic perspective and neutrality.
Journalistic
perspective and neutrality. And I tell them that when you're reporting from an area like Bastar, and when you use these terms, that it feels like hopscotch. So I think we're living in very dangerous times in many
because
ways.
Because of the nature of journalists?
Because of what is happening in the country, really dark times. We're the biggest democracy in the world. But sometimes you're really surprised at the kind of indifference, really, we see in what is now known as the red zone.
As a journalist, do you think that not enough space is given to this kind of conflict or these kind of issues in the mainstream media?
I think the problem lies both sides. On one hand,
both sides, other side being which one?
From the journalism side, from the side of the journalists also.
Okay.
You have this talk increasing in newsrooms. I speak to some of my friends who are in television, and they want to report from an area like Bastar, etc. And they say they use this word called human resource intensive story. So going to Bastar for a journalist and paying for his or her stay
is
human resource intensive. But if you have to put three OB vans for Aishwarya Rai's daughter, that's not human resource intensive at all. The other problem from journalism side is journalists also have become very lazy. So what you end up, nobody wants to go to Bastar. It's not that difficult also. And even if when you go to an area like Bastar, what you ideally want to do is that, you travel from your hotel, go to a particular village with a local guide or a resource person, take a couple of quotes, meet people, what editors call color. So you have the color, and then you would always want to return to the luxury of a clean hotel in Jagdalpur, for example, in Chhattisgarh's case. Mm. But
do you think that gets in the way of the reporting? Have to spend time there.
You need to spend time because
Okay, sorry, quickly. Bastar 101 for our viewers who don't know what the big deal about Bastar is. there's a big deal about Bastar.
Well, Bastar is really the epicenter of the Maoist insurgency.
Which is a lot of violence there.
It's a really large area in Chhattisgarh, where the Maoists are very consolidated. So much so that there are areas where the policemen don't dare to venture.
Liberated zones.
They call it Pakistan.
Okay, right.
So that's what Bastar is all about. In some areas, they
have... So what's it like going to Bastar? I mean, just break it down that you get on a bus, you get off there, you go in, someone puts a gun to your head, why you're here? Does any of that happen?
No, it doesn't work like that. I remember a couple of years ago, a senior journalist had done a book about Maoists, and he had the only problem with that book was that it was a book about Maoists, but he hadn't been able to manage meeting even a grassroots cadre.
Who?
Yeah. Well, let's not name, but.
You know, this is what I don't like about news people. They will protect each other.
My friends all over, but will know. So I made a very nasty comment which I shouldn't have, and I said, he went to Dantewada and must have spent time on a tea shop, etc. And must have spoken to people and saying, where are the Dada Log? You know, Dada Log are the Naxals. And they would have said, oh, sahab, hame pata nahi, and all that stuff. So I made this nasty comment, and, you know, they would be Naxals, and he wouldn't have known of it. So I made this nasty comment. I said, you know, Naxals are not like Coke bottles. They're not to be found everywhere. So just because you land up in Dantewada doesn't mean that you'll establish contact with Naxal guerrilla. It takes a lot of time. Yes, it takes a lot of time.
So how does it take them? How did you establish contact?
Well, you know, over the past 12 years, I've sort of evolved a working relationship with the CPM, you know, the Maoist guerrilla.
That's because you're an actual sympathizer. Other than being a right-wing fascist.
The other problem is that I keep on saying, people, because I've interviewed the Supreme Commander, and I'm one of those... very few people who actually met him in person. He's done a couple of interviews with the BBC, but he's not met many people in person. So they somehow think that, you know, I have a hotline with Ganapati.
So
I
can dangerous is it to actually
it,
get
it,
there?
It is dangerous. So, you know...
why did you do it?
I'm a conflict reporter, that's my job, and I got an opportunity, it's a lifetime opportunity to meet someone like Mupalla Lakshman Rao Ganapati. So I got a chance, it was not planned at all, I was traveling in these areas, and he came to know about me, he's seen some of work.
Your mom doesn't get pissed off with you?
Well, my parents are worried at times.
Of course.
They are, but...
If I have to drive to Jaipur, my mother is saying, "Jaan se jaana."
Sometimes I don't tell them exactly, but sometimes it's very scary because, you know, you're traveling on for a week altogether and you have
personal forces are working against you doing this. I mean, that's obvious.
Yeah, they are.
So then why?
Well, I'll tell you a small story. Actually, there are a couple of stories. I don't know whether you have time for this
or not. We have, of course.
You know, in 2003, I was in Jordan, and we were hoping to cross across to Baghdad. And I had this driver, Palestinian driver called Muhammad, who used to drive me around Jordan. There was not much to do in Jordan, but anyway, we used to roam around and meet people, and people who had fled from Iraq, and Palestinian refugees who would chant slogans in favor of Saddam Hussein. So every day when I used to sit in his taxi, he would utter this very funny song, an Arabic ditty, really. It used to go something like this: "Bush, bush, shili dak hadal hachi mai fi dak." So I used to find it very funny. So one day I asked him what it really means. So roughly translated in English, it means, "Bush, don't put your hands into Iraq. You'll burn your hands." So after a point of time, you know, a couple of journalists, we got together and we managed to pull some strings in within the Jordan, Jordanian government. And they allowed us to cross over to this border called the Al-Karama border, which is the beginning of Iraq, the Jordan-Iraq border. And we were caught by the Republican guards on the border, and they started talking to us, and I picked up a couple of Arabic words. I said, "Sahafi, you know, journalist, Taswir, I'm a video journalist." So all of a sudden, you're the chief of the Republican Guard there. He became hostile all of a sudden, and they started cocking their AK-47 rifles.
Oh my God.
And there's this woman, Romanian journalist with me. I'm looking at her, her legs are shaking, and can't dare look at my own legs. Some kind of divine intervention, I don't know what happened. I started singing this song.
Yeah, are you serious?
"Bush, bush, shili da khadal hachi mai."
Just like that?
Just like that. Divine intervention. And the first reaction was, his barrel came down. He caught hold of his stomach and he was rolling with laughter on the floor. So for the next about 1 hour,
that's a very cool story.
He made, assembled everyone and made me sing this song about 50-60 times. After a point of time,
so like
I was so
like a boy being ragged in
it was ragging. After a point in time, I was so desperate. I thought if he asked me to sing it once again, I'll say, put a bullet across my shoulder. But that didn't happen, and of course they didn't let us go to Baghdad, but they sent us back in a car
alive
to Jordan. Of course, after a couple of days, we crossed over to Baghdad. So when I came back from Baghdad after my reporting, I realized that I was so stressed that I'd forgotten the PIN number of my ATM card. Now, it may be a small deal for you, but it's a big deal for me because I have a John Nash kind of fascination with numbers. I would even remember my 10th class exam roll number. It was 616564. So, you know, sometimes you end up doing it. The other story which I was wanting to tell you is this woman, a widow in Jharkhand. You know, the politician, the administration has become very thick-skinned. It doesn't matter whether you're a journalist, they don't care. But sometimes this power of Delhi se aaye hai, it really works in certain areas. So there was this widow who would not get her widow pension fund, etc. So she told me this whole story. And I ended up picking my phone and speaking to the collector. So after speaking to her, I went ahead. And after 2-3 days, I came back. And she was glad because her work was done.
Because so of Delhi size.
Yes, out of love, she cooked us a sabzi of jackfruit tree, kathal ki sabzi. And she almost fed us with her own hands. And I was overwhelmed. You know, I was so overwhelmed that I had to look elsewhere to control my emotions. So for that jackfruit tree meal, I'm willing to forget the PIN number of my ATM card 1,000 times.
Fair enough, but still the reality, I mean, if you break it down in basic terms of going out there and getting the kind of interviews that you need to do a book like Bastar.
Well, it's very difficult, let me put it this way. It's becoming increasingly...
So then does it surprise you that because the cost-benefit analysis is so dismal, such few people actually do it?
Actually, I'm really passionate about what I do. You know, it's very important for me as a conflict writer to travel in these areas and bring out stories which otherwise get buried in the debris of what you read in Delhi, you know, in national newspapers and on media. So sometimes, even if you're able to do such one story a month or one in 2 months, I think your job as a conflict reporter is done.
You're basically been with print most of your life?
I started my career with television. I was with television for a long time. I've done a stint with Zee and Aastak later. And I made a transition from television to print at a time when a lot of print senior print journalists were making the other way around. So, I mean, I obviously took a huge salary cut because after a point of time, TV really became senseless for some of us.
Why?
Because you couldn't do the kind of stories you would do. You know, TV as a medium has always been shallow in some ways or the other, but you know, even if you manage,
do you think print has depth?
Well, at least compared to television, even if you're able to go to Bastar and do that human resource intensive story, I think you're fine.
Okay, but just kind of things that you're telling me are very visual,
right?
I would think they would make more compelling television stories or documentaries, long format, than they would print.
But it's not possible all the time to document these things on camera. For example, this brief encounter I had on the Alkanama border, I couldn't have captured it on
television. Not that one.
But yes, of course, one thing happens is that my stint with television has at least, you know, I'm trained in television journalism. So I at least think in terms of visuals. Right. So I think that's... something.
What do you think of the 26/11 coverage by Indian Television News?
What about it? Well, I think it was pathetic.
Does that qualify as conflict reporting?
Well, in some sort of. Some ways, yes.
Okay. Yeah, what do you think of
it? If you're lying on the ground and bullets are flying around you, I think you're all right. But you know, the real threat in a conflict area is really not from bullets. It's from so many other factors, like you know, you're going to Bastar, your biggest enemy.
But if it's next to Taj, then it's just around the corner. You can have
you grab a Coca-Cola and you'll be
and
fine.
You come back.
Okay. Burger, yes.
But you thought it was pathetic, the television reportage.
It's partially the government's weakness also. You know, in times like these, you don't really give television a free hand. You know, you have to establish certain norms. You know, the television coverage ended up helping the terrorists who were holed up inside because they were getting the same visuals
that everybody else was.
So, you know, it's horrible.
Okay, I read the Open magazine fairly regularly, and I don't know whether it's fair for me to ask you this question because Manu Joseph and Hartosh Singh are also right.
They're my colleagues, yeah.
I find that A, they're always very angry.
Okay.
The pieces.
Oh.
They come from a position of great anger,
which is good, isn't it?
But yeah. And two, they're like someone, they'll always go the other way. When everyone was saying Anna, you're saying Bah, Anna. And when you're saying Bah, Anna, then you're saying no, Anna did the right thing by flogging them because it was effective. Is there a conscious thing of
I don't think there's a conscious...
Do you read that piece?
Which one?
Basically, when this Anna was supposed to have said, which was completely wrongly reported by most people as is normal, that people who drink should be flogged. There's a difference of people who drink should be flogged, and I flogged some men who were getting drunk and beating their wives 22 years ago. The two are different, but most people chose not to see that.
Right.
However, the only magazine that carried a piece that what Anna did made logical sense because it was effective.
But you don't expect a Gandhian to say that, is it?
Yeah, exactly. No, what I'm saying is, but when everybody else was trashing Anna for that, Open appreciated Anna for that.
I don't think it's a conscious decision.
To go against the parents?
Against the tide, it just happens. And you know, these are editorial decisions which are taken by my superiors, including Hartosh. So I'm not really in the loop, you know, the editorial loop. I'm a single man entity, you know. I'm fairly independent that way. I mean, I report to my superiors, but I'm restricted to.
You think you'll ever go back to television?
Television, no, not
Why
at
not?
All. Why not? Oh well, it's like I said, it's.
You look down on it?
Not at all. I mean, some of.
You look at it with disdain. Come on, you do. I can
see
it in
your
face.
Not all of them. But it's a. it's a overall thing. But some of my friends in television. We have a friend. She's done a fabulous.
I think she's fantastic. She's a journalist.
She's a very good journalist. So there are some journalists who are doing some really good work. But personally speaking, I couldn't.
The nature of work that you enjoy doing in conflict zones.
Yeah, it's. I don't think it's possible.
Okay, now we've bitched out journalists and all. But if there's some youngsters watching this who want to get into conflict journalism as well,
you need to have a lot of grit. You need to understand that nobody. Should be able to take away your grit. And then, of course, number two is, this lazy journalism I keep on talking about. You know, I'm very disappointed with the kind of youngsters, who are coming and they say, because television has always, become very glamorous.
Yeah.
So, overnight they want to become television anchors so that everyone in their neighborhood, in their apartment knows them.
Recognize
them.
But,
it's not easy. And sometimes they come to me and say, who is the commissioner of Delhi police? They have no idea. Have you read the newspaper in the morning? Yes, sir. We read every day. Okay, what was the headline in Times of India today? Sir, today I couldn't read because I got, I was doing an assignment late in the night. That's not how journalism works,
Right. Do you think the reason people are becoming journalists?
It's true for every other profession that you need to have a lot of hard work. But it's essentially more true for journalism because you have to come to journalism with a lot of passion.
The reason people are becoming journalists is becoming increasingly flawed.
I would say it's really mixed. Some youngsters who are really interested in journalism as a career, they are influenced by other reporters they see.
How about you? Who are you influenced by? Which journalists do you appreciate or like?
Well, my role model really, as far as reporting concerned, is this Polish journalist who's no more. His name is Rizat Kapusinski.
Okay.
He was a brilliant conflict reporter.
He died in action?
Oh no! He died a natural death.
Okay.
He has seen. He was sentenced to death 5 times. In Africa, in Latin America, etc. He's seen 27 coups in life. He was brilliant. So the other few journalists I really look up to is a war reporter called Janine Di Giovanni. She's a journalist based in France. Now, she has seen a lot of action. You should read some of her books. It's a book based on the Balkan War. It's called Madness.
She's seen a lot of action.
No, action as in war. She's been to Afghanistan
Kosovo,
everywhere else. Oh, she's really brilliant. Her memoir is actually out recently, where she talks about the things I talked about. Because here, journalists are also human beings. You see so much, you end up becoming this pressure cooker of emotions. So she leaves her job, she leaves her reporting for some time, and she falls in love with this French cameraman, and they get married, and they shift to Paris. And Paris is a completely normal city, but she has so many nightmares of her past experiences that she starts bottling up water in her apartment in Paris thinking that the city will be under siege shortly. So that's what conflict journalism can do to you at times.
You worry that'll happen to you?
Well, you know, in some ways it leaves an indelible impression on you. I remember, you know, a long time back I covered a war. When I came back, I was very young, I was 23. I came back and for months I would get this nightmare that someone was picking me up and making me fall, push me from a cliff. But of course, I drank a lot of whiskey and I did some running and I was fine after that.
In the dream or in real life?
No, in real life.
Okay.
In dream, that doesn't work really.
Okay, now, if I may try to do this dissection. You grew up in conflict Kashmir?
Yes.
And you left when you were 14?
Yes, sir.
And you're a very obsessive conflict journalist, as I have learned, some details. You think that they're related, the two are connected, but you seem very peaceful, man. You have this almost Buddha-like face with very sweet smile.
No, not really.
Do you think they're connected?
But I think, yeah, that's,
and you're obsessed about conflict.
Sure, I don't think there's a connection, except the fact that since I've seen conflict firsthand, I'm a victim of that. You know, I was forced out of my house, to a home, like hundreds of thousands of other families at the age of 14. And it was, it was like partition as far as we are concerned.
Right.
So, I've seen suffering personally. So I think that kind of leads, I have some empathy in my mind when I go to the tribal.
Empathy is very important as a journalist.
Yes, of course.
I personally think so. I think one reason, I mean, there are 100 criticisms of journalism, but journalists today, because all of them, in the English space at least, belong to a particular class, there's very little empathy when it comes to reporting. That is why you just see one kind of reporting in the English space.
But why should empathy be associated with class? I'm from a middle class family, but when I go to the tribal areas, where people think that hunger is a disease, I was just narrating an incident which I saw in 98. I was meeting this middle-aged tribal Adivasi.
But you went there as a journalist,
as a journalist. And his son had died the previous week and I got to speak to him. I said, how did he die? He said, he died of disease. I said, what disease? He said, bhooka bimari. So when I came back, of course I'm a city.
Now the thing is, you have to go there to have experience and then you come back changed. What I'm saying is that not everybody will have that experience.
Yeah.
And purely because of that, when we're sitting in our studios.
You have to have some degree of empathy even you, when you're there, when I went there.
But just to make a choice of whether you go there or not, you have to have empathy.
Absolutely.
So do you think there is just the nature of what is chosen to be done as a story is determined by empathy? I mean, isn't that right? I mean, what is important as a human being to you or to me? Like, the latest phone gadget, I don't understand technology, so it's not important to me. To someone, there's a thrill, it's emotionally connected. How you react to stuff is emotionally connected.
Right.
So don't you think empathy is an extremely important part of being a journalist? Because that will determine what story you choose.
Of course. I agree, yes.
So, because of that, do you think there is a need for the kind of stories you're talking about?
Yeah, we need to sensitize ourselves.
And that only happens if you've grown up in a certain environment, isn't that right? I mean, that's...
No, not really. I mean, it's an extreme example to say, Kobad Gandhi, the senior Maoist ideologue, he was not really a journalist. Mm-hmm. And he came from a very,
Do you sympathize with him?
With Kobad? Mm. Oh, yes, I do.
So then you're a Maoist sympathizer. Well, kidding.
That's all right. No. I like my good old friend Nilesh.
I think he's an amazing guy.
Like my good old friend Nilesh Mishra says, I prefer a label on my forehead than blinkers on my eyes. There you go.
Absolutely. Fantastic. Yeah. Pleasure talking to you, yeah. Good luck, and I don't hope you do a lot more conflict reporting, because then I will be hoping for conflict, which I'm not.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure.